Hey there folks, Gary Bradley here, and in this video I'm going to show you how you can create pop art effects inside of Illustrator. I'm going to try and recreate a Roy Lichtenstein styled artwork. So I started off with a pencil sketch which I scanned and then brought through into Adobe Photoshop, mainly because I needed something to work to inside of Illustrator. I added a levels adjustment inside of Adobe Photoshop just to enhance the contrast between the pencil marks and the paper background. I then flattened the image again so I could then overwrite the original JPEG of the scan, and I could use that inside of Illustrator. And then inside of Adobe Illustrator, I went for A4 print file and I left the orientation of this set to portrait. I also added a 3mm of bleed around the outside. Notice that the colors are also set to CMYK as well. And with that done, I made the file. So you can see in the layers panel here, the layers by default are very small, so I made them a little bit bigger just so we could see what's going a bit clearer. So I set the thumbnails to be large inside of there, and then I brought the artwork in from Photoshop, which was the JPEG file of course, but this time I chose template layer. Now that's going to be really handy for tracing from. You can see here the name it imports from the JPEG file at the bottom of the layer stack, so I'll come to that later. But I renamed the original layer one in there to be called BKG, which stands for background. I gave this kind of a neutral color because I'm going to build the artwork up in this file from the back of the composition to the front. And then it was a case of then bringing the colors through that I needed. So I've got a library of colors inside of Illustrator that I made that were called pop in here. Again, you can download the original artwork for this and my pencil sketch to work with, and those colors will be included as well. They were set up to be kind of match a pop print style, essentially. It got some dots inside of there for patterns as well. And I'm just setting the panels up in here inside of Illustrator so I can apply colors and work with the appearances as well. So then it was a case of start to draw and create all the shapes. So I actually started off with the curvature tool. And if you've never used this before, this is great for long sweeping curves. So made that one active. And then of course, make sure that I don't have a fill color active, because yeah, that fill color will hide whatever it is that I'm tracing. So I set the fill color to none, hit return. I kept with a black stroke at one point in thickness and then hovered over the edge of where my pencil sketch is here, and then left click and let go of the mouse. And you won't see anything change in your artwork until you hover over in a different place and left click and let go of the mouse. So no dragging with this tool, it's just a series of left clicks. And when I hover the cursor away, that's when it starts to put the curvature in there. So essentially you'll need one node per curve. And if I go into the inside where I've got a curve in here and left click, it puts a point in there. And again, on the outside, left click, and wherever I've got a curve, whether it's coming in or out from the artboard, I will add those in there. So you can keep adding these round, and I'll work my way around this path in here, and I'll speed this up so you're not stuck with the tedious nature of me going through this at normal speed. And then once I've got the nodes in place, it was a case of moving them around. So you can just hover over, left click to activate the node and drag it around. So you can stick with the same tool for all of these edits. You might find, again, like a lot of paths, there's a little bit of back and forth with these just to move them around, and then click and drag and reposition them. So yeah, it's pretty neat. You know, it's one of those rare tools that you create and edit with the same tool. And where you feel like you need an extra one in here, I need a little bit of extra node in there, so I can hover over the edge, left click to add a node, and then click and drag and pull it in there like so. So you can do that. And again, if I drag this one around here, hover over the path where there is an existing node, click to add one, and then drag it into position. Again, a little bit of back and forth in there to match the pencil sketch. But that's the technique I followed to edit that in there. And again, I'll speed up the next part of the video just to save a bit of time. And that's the outside shape made for now. I'm going to leave these all set to just strokes at the moment, not going to put any colors in there until the very end. And then in terms of the shapes in the middle now, I wanted to separate out the background artwork from the foreground. So the outer stuff around the edges, I'm going to leave set into the background layer, went in here to the layers panel, added a new layer, and then double clicked on there, and then call that foreground, and then picked magenta. Click OK. So I'm building all my artwork in the foreground layer now, and I actually then switched to the pen tool. I'm going to zoom in here, and again I'm going to work from the outside in. So select, deselect, and then I essentially just clicked in all the inside parts of this path. The one on the very outside. Now, I know there's a lot going on in here, so it was just a case of going to the very inside. I'm not putting any curvature in here. Once I'd drawn the path, then it was a case of putting the curves in. So the really neat thing is now if you click and hold down on the pen tool, you can get to the anchor point tool. And again, this only works if each of the anchor points are corner anchor points. So you'll have to just be a left click and let go of the mouse to add your corner points in there. No clicking and dragging with the mouse. And then you get these straight lines. You can then hover your cursor wherever you want to start adding the curvature and click and drag and pull out that curve. You can also go to the handles and then pull those out wider if you wish to as well. This is a case then of pulling these out and just getting them to the curvature style that I needed in here. So again, you can stick with this one tool to edit both the add the curvature and edit the handles. So I'm holding down the space bar to pan around here as well, and then just adjust those as I go around. So you can see the gist of this. Again, I'll speed this up. Final thing then is just to put some basic colors into all these shapes. So I'm going to select the shape in the background, go to the window menu, and then go down to the color panel so that I can make sure I've got either the fill or the stroke active in here. And then for the fill, I'm going to apply a dot. Now these thumbnails are very small, so I'm going to set these to large thumbnail view and then click on that dot inside of there. Now, if you haven't made patterns before, my video that I posted last week, I've got a link at the top of the screen to that of how you make your own patterns. You can see how I made this type pattern as well. And then I'm going to remove the stroke from this. So I'm going to target the stroke and then choose none. And that, as you can see, is even more kind of hard on the eye to spot. So it's in the background layer. I'm going to hide that one and then focus on the colors for the remainder in here. We've got the red, the off-white, the yellow, and the purple. Now, I'm going to select all of those, and then I'm just going to make sure that the stroke appearance is active, and then I'm going to apply that purple to all of them, except the one that's got the purple fill that doesn't need the stroke on there. And then with that one active, I'm going to remove the stroke appearance from that one. So everything apart from the one that's got the solid purple in, for the fill color, they've all got a purple outline around them for the stroke. In the next section, we'll focus on adding the realistic print effects in here. So to achieve this lithograph print effect inside of Illustrator, we've got a few steps to work with this on this front object, and it's predominantly done in the appearance panel. So first thing is I need to change the thickness of the stroke on this object. And I'm going to do that with a width tool. So over here, this icon, which kind of looks like Loch Ness with a paddle, is a width tool. I'm going to hover over the existing purple stroke in there, hovering over the edge of that, click and hold down the mouse and drag towards the middle of the object. If nothing happens, then try dragging on the outside and you'll thicken the stroke in that region. If you make it really big, you can always hover over the middle. You can drag that around. You could change the position of where it thickens in there. You can also hover your cursor over the handles and you can thin that back down again. So I'm just going to drag that back around here and thin it down a touch. Don't need to be that thick in there. And then I'll work that way around all the other curves on this object to achieve that kind of appearance. So there we go. That is the stroke now thickened in certain areas. Just to add to that pop art effect, I'll then switch to my selection tool. And then we need to focus on the appearance panel for this next portion. So in order to create this kind of lithograph offset print effect, we need to be able to do some work with the fill and the stroke inside of here above and beyond what we've already got. So currently, the appearance panel, if you've never used it before, is showing us that we've got a stroke in here and a fill with purple for the stroke and red for the fill. And the way these work is the items that are higher up in the list in here appear towards the front of the objects. If I just very quickly show you by clicking on the stroke, If I click and drag and pull the stroke behind the fill by dragging it underneath it, you notice there, it changes appearance. If I drag the stroke higher up the list and in front of the fill, you'll now see all of the strokes. So there is a hierarchy to how things appear on your objects from front to back and vice versa. So the first thing is I'm going to click on the fill and we need to add a second fill to this, which you can do by going down here and clicking on add new fill. Now it will duplicate whatever you've got on the object. So now it's showing me my second red fill. I'm going to click on the original one down here, click in the pop-up menu and pick a different color. I'm going to choose my off-white for my pop in there and press return, which doesn't appear because again, it's lower down in the list in the appearance panel. It's hidden by the second fill in there, which is the red. So if I click on that second fill for the red and then go down to the FX icon and then going to choose distort and transform and then choose transform, I can move this out of the way. So just to help this, I'm going to go to the scale for the horizontal and the vertical, just tap this down to 99 for each of these. And then in terms of the move, well, I'm going to move this 0.5 millimeters for both of them in there. Like so. You see that shifting now. And that's because I've applied this transform effect to just the red fill, nothing else on the object. And what it's now doing is that red fill has been shifted towards the right hand side, slightly lower down, and it's revealing the off-white of the fill that's lower down in this list in here, this one here. So that done now, click OK. And then I'm going to change the opacity in here. So for my opacity, I'm going to change that to multiply and then press return. And then the final step is to close that down and then take the red for the fill and drag it higher up and in front of the stroke in there. And if I now zoom in, you will see that our red fill, if I just go to select and choose deselect, now just offsets and then it's just running into the stroke in there to give us this appearance. So that is getting us part of the way there. Then what you need to do is make sure you select your object. And then I'm going to go to my stroke appearance, then go down to FX, distort and transform, and then choose roughen, which will tend to do this. It has a very high impact, does the roughen filter. So for this one, I'm going to make sure that the, in terms of the appearance of its points, it's set to smooth, not corner, and it will do this. And then for the size, it needs to be set really, really low. So swipe over that one and type in 0.05, hit the tab key to see update. And we get this appearance in here. So it's slightly uneven, but it's hard to spot because we need to go finally to the detail slider and drag that all the way to the far end. And we now start to get this uneven edge around the outside of our stroke in here, just to make it look a little bit more roughened and a little less neat and vectorized. So with that done, I could then click OK, and that completes part of the appearance for that particular part of the artwork. So I'm going to apply that same sort of style to the rest of the artwork in the document, and then I'm going to show you a couple of extra tricks you can use to make this look like it is a kind of there. And then what we need to do is pick up my rectangle tool and then making sure I'm working in the background layer in here, create a backdrop, a flat color in there, which is the off-white. That will then need to be set to the background. So object range, send to back. So we get a nice off-white color inside of there. Switch to my selection tool and then I'll lock the object as well. So object and then lock. Selection. And then as a final step, I added those lines coming from the center, those kind of explosive lines. Now, this is the whole reason why you create a template layer, because if I just move these out of the way, notice here we had our template layer, and it is, in terms of its properties, it's set to template. It will dim the artwork by 50% to make it easy for you to trace over, and you can see your artwork clearly, and the thing you're tracing is dimmed slightly. But the really neat thing about this is that if I go to view and choose outline, your template layers will not be outlined. You'll still be able to see them nice and clearly, but your vector artwork will be just outlined in there, and it will allow me then to click back on my background layer and add in there those explosive lines coming from the back in there. Final thing then is to create kind of another print type effect over this. This needs to be applied to the foreground layer. Again, I'm going to pick up my rectangle tool and draw a rectangle that goes across all of the artwork in here, right out to the bleed line. And then need to make sure that the remove the stroke goes to the fill, set that to white, or the off-white in there. And then I'll need to go to my appearance panel again, down to effects, and then choose a Photoshop effect inside of here, which will be effect gallery. And then I'll need to expand these open and choose reticulation. So this will put a grainy effect over the top of this. So really the only one that really has a high impact in here is density, really. So you can have this set to be more black. If I drag this out here like so, you can have more white in there, but I'm going to set this a little bit lower in there, to about there. So I want a nice grainy effect, and then click OK. Which looks like this, and obviously looks completely horrendous. But if I go down to opacity and then change that to screen, we get that effect. And you can always alter the opacity of that now. So if I change that to say 20%, hit return. You can vary that and control it completely separate to everything else. If I wanted to bump that up, I could always then just type in 30 in there and just see what works. So that's how you create pop art style lithograph effects inside of Illustrator. Thanks for watching, folks. I know this is a long one, but there's a lot of techniques in this one. So if you're not a subscriber, you can always subscribe to the channel. We post here every week. Click on the bell to get a notification if you want to save loads of time, create great looking artwork, and please give it a thumbs up if you enjoyed the video. And until next time, farewell.